today I'm going to teach you everything you need to know about caring for a ghost mantis.
1, 2, 3,
fuck it.
Housing. Ghost mantis, or the Philocrania paradoxa, should be kept in an enclosure that is at least 3 times as tall as the mantis is long, and at least 2 times as wide as the mantis is long. Luckily, ghost mantids are a fairly small species, so it's easy to find a suitable enclosure. Adult ghost mantises are about 2 inches long, with little difference between the sexes. The cage must have adequate ventilation and some kind of material on the ceiling of the enclosure, which will allow the mantis to hang upside down during molts, as well as an empty space at the top, which is at least 2 times the size of the mantis. They can be kept in glass or mesh cages, or if you choose to keep them in enclosures with glass or clear plastic sides, a mesh or screen top from which they can easily hang upside down is a necessity. Ghost mantises don't cannibalize as much as other species of mantids, therefore they can be housed in groups. However, as with any other species of mantis, it is still possible. They will turn on each other if there is not enough food. Tank should include plenty of sticks and plants, big or little, to give them plenty of space to spread out and places to perch. Temperature and humidity. They should do well being kept anywhere between 65 and 80 degrees Fahrenheit. Ideally, humidity should stay in the range of 50% to 70% relative humidity. The enclosure should be given light misting at least once a day so they can drink. When kept in mesh cages, we mist their enclosures twice a day. Most mantises do not like getting sprayed directly, so it is best to try and spray around the mantis, but if you get them a little wet by accident, it is usually no big deal. Use spring water, distilled water, or water filtered by reverse osmosis, but do not use plain tap water. Feeding. Ghost mantises prefer flying insects throughout their entire life cycle. L1 and L2 nymphs should be fed D-melon ghoster fruit flies. L3 and L4 nymphs should be fed Drosophila heidi fruit flies. L5 nymphs to adults should be fed house flies and blue bottle flies. These mantises will never actively chase prey insects. Instead, they'll stay completely still, disguised as a part of the environment, and it'll only strike when an unsuspecting insect walks by and is within grabbing range. This is why ground-dwelling prey insects are not good candidates for the ghost mantis. Ghost mantises usually prefer to hang upside down in tree branches or from top of their enclosure, and rarely will they be seen on the ground of an enclosure. They're also prone to being easily intimidated by prey insects, especially if they perceive the insect as being too big for them to properly catch and eat. Prey items should be no longer than a mantis's head, as their arms are not strong enough to properly catch very large prey insects. Development. The molt from L1 to L2 takes only about 2 weeks, and L2 to L3 is just a few days longer. L3 to L4 is less than 3 weeks, but then L4 to L5 can take up to a month. Males are easily identified after 2 molts because the expansion of the male's prothorax is much smaller and the leaf on the head is pinched in the middle. Both genders are about 2 inches long when fully grown, but the female is much more massive. Her tegmina look like dried brown leaves complete with veins, while the male's tegmina looks more like the hind wings and give him an odd rectangular shape. Sexing can be done as early as L4 by looking at the head crown. Males have a tall, jagged crown, while females have a forked and structured symmetrical head crown. And as nymphs get older, males will have a narrower range of colors, mainly black and grays, while females take on browns and greens. Surprisingly, males can take longer than females to reach adulthood. Fortunately, they are quick to breed. These are an extremely prolific species. Both sexes can be ready to mate as early as 2 weeks into adulthood. Males barely eat but are active and fly readily. Females eat a lot and should be nice and well fed before mating. You don't usually have to worry about females attacking the males, especially if she's well fed. A good way to breed them is to have the male in a warm, humid cage, 80-ounce cup with wet paper towel under a heat lamp works fine, and then warm for 2 days or so. Then in the evening, put in a female or two. Usually you wake up to a connected pair. They stay connected for 2 to 8 hours, and the females will lay oofs frequently. Try not to keep females too warm after mating, since they have a habit of laying small oofs every few days rather than long ones every week and a half. Oofica. Giving them fake plants to lay on also helps increase oofulin. Oofs can be incubated at room temperature with twice weekly misting. Hatching occurs 6 to 10 weeks later with 20 to 60 nymphs resulting. females can lay well over 12 oofs in their lifetime. They prefer to construct oophakai on sticks a quarter inch or less diameter. Oophakai are similar in shape and size to creel brooder oophakai, but the surface is smooth and glossy, and there is a long thread-like extension on one end.
First step, you want to grab you a cup or a container that's at least three times as tall as the mantis and twice as long, I believe. Next, I realized I forgot to add this in the first video where I was showing you how to make terrariums, but you want to add a false bottom, not only to separate the substrate and the water, but also to help keep the humidity in the tank. So what you do is you just get some rocks or some river stones. I'm using these. Make sure to boil them and get all the pesticides or any chemicals that may be on it off of it. And you just put them at the bottom of the cup. Once you have your false bottom set up, what you want to do is you want to add a layer that'll separate the substrate and the false bottom. Go up and make the whole tank more humid. Once you've poked all the little holes in your plastic bag or your plastic cutout, you want to get your cup. See, right on top of the rocks, you just lay it flat and boom, there you go. You got a barrier in between your substrate and your rock. Next, you wanna grab some cocoa husk. I got my cocoa husk mixed with a little bit of sphagnum moss, but some normal cocoa husk would do. And just put it right on top of plastic. Praying mantids don't really like to burrow much, so you don't have to worry about making it deep. Just like, make it to where they have something to stand on while they're in it, because you still need some room for the praying mantis to hang upside down for when it molts and whatnot. Okay, yeah, that barrier worked mostly good. Now, this is just a personal preference. I'm sure you've probably seen it in every single one of the terrariums I've set up. I like to just add a little bit of bamboo to all the terrariums. Not to mention, it gives the mantis something to climb on and hold on to when it molts, so you should probably put something in there. Even if it's just like some twig, make sure nothing on it, no hitchhiking bugs or anything. Normal little plant and stick it right in the dirt and there you go. I'm gonna put a few more in there just so that this thing has somewhere to climb at all time. I think I might keep some of the leaves on this one. All right, once you got all your twigs or your sticks or bamboo like me in there, what you wanna do? Well, what I like to do personally, just to give the tank some color, I just like to add some sheet moss to it. Make sure to rinse the sheet moss off really well with some purified or distilled water before you put it in. But yeah, you just grab some of this and just stick it in there right in the dirt. And it'll actually support some of your branches. Or like if you see your twigs aren't standing up too well on their own, you can just kind of put the moss around it and you kind of solve that problem. All right, once you got all your moss in there, what you want to do is just mist it down real nice and good. That way it'll be plenty of humid if your mantis needs to molt. And you don't even gotta worry about any excess water, because all the excess water is gonna drip right down to your false bottom. Because all the extra water is gonna drip right down to your false bottom. And we won't have to worry about sitting and mixing with the substrate or getting real soggy. You'll just hold the water there and continually release it from the bottom to keep the whole enclosure nice and humid. After you complete all that, your mantis enclosure will be complete. First thing you wanna do is grab a 32-ounce cup to make sure the flies don't climb out of it. And you wanna get some Vaseline and rub it all over the rim of the cup. And go as deep as you can, really, because you don't want them climbing up too high or jumping or any of that. You see, I already covered mine. Next, you wanna get your fruit fly culture and just tap the top. If you're sure that they're all at the bottom, you're gonna hurry up, just crack the lid a bit, and tap. Okay, I put a little too many in there, but it's enough for them. The extractor probably just... Most mantids eat about, like, at least L2, L3 mantids can eat about 3 to 4 flies every 2 days. I usually just feed Danny 3. From here, you open up the container that you're keeping your mantid in. See him chilling right there. Grab your cup. And you just gotta get however many you're feeding them in there. I'm just gonna get 3. 1. 2. Wait, 1 second. One of them's already trying to climb out. Usually you gotta do this a little quicker, but... okay, there's 3 in there. 3. And you close the top so they don't climb out or jump out.
I hope you all like this informative style of video, contrary to our normal tutorial type videos. If you did like it and it helped you, make sure to leave a like and subscribe so you can be notified instantly when we post our next video. Have a great day.